एवरीवन, ग्रीटिंग्स फ्रॉम सी विद्या निकेतन पब्लिक स्कूल श्रीराम नगर। वेलकम टू ज्योग्राफी ऑनलाइन क्लास। टुडे वी विल लर्न फर्स्ट चैप्टर इन ज्योग्राफी, दैट इज रिसोर्सेज एंड डेवलपमेंट। बिफोर वी कुड नो द मीनिंग ऑफ रिसोर्स, वी सी दैट इन आवर डेली लाइफ वी मेक यूज ऑफ सो मेनी थिंग्स। फॉर एग्जाम्पल, आई एम यूजिंग ए मोबाइल फोन एंड सेंडिंग ए फोटोग्राफ टू वन ऑफ माई फ्रेंड। So this has helped me to send the photograph to my friend. Mobile phone has helped me to send the photograph. In the same way, instead of going to bank, I may make use of Paytm and transfer money to one of my relative. These things have made my life as comfortable. In the same way, we see that so many things are available in nature. Take for example, sun, which provides us sunlight. In the same way, water. In the same way, wind, forest, from which we get wood and convert it into furniture. All these things are called as natural resources. Apart from natural resources, there are some resources which are made by human beings. They are called as man-made resources. For example, from forest, we cut wood and this wood is utilized for making furniture. So wood is available in nature, and when it is converted into a furniture by human beings, and which is making our life what you call a comfortable way. So this is how we see that natural resources also are there, and what you call man-made resources also are available in nature. So all these things we are making use in our daily life. Can we call all the things as a resource? No, we cannot call all the things as resources. Only those things which are going to satisfy the human needs, those only are being termed as resources. And this resource, to be called as a resource, it has to fulfill certain features or characteristics. Like a resource, if it is to be called as a resource, it should be technologically accessible, culturally acceptable and economically feasible. Then we see, take for example gold, which is available in the interior of the earth. Are we going to dig the ground and make use of it? No. So we need to adopt a technology there to extract the mineral from there, and then we are going to get it in the, after adopting technology, we found that is the pure form of gold is available to us. And the same thing, if we say gold is available everywhere, but people are not bothered and they do not consider it as a what you call resource. Can we call it as a resource? No, we cannot call it as a resource. Technologically accessible and culturally it should be acceptable. And the third term we are going to see is economically feasible. It means that in the extraction of gold, once again if you take the example, we have what you call our input was 1 crore amount, and the output what we gained from extraction was just 50,000 rupees. Is it worth spending a huge amount to extract the mineral which is having what you call a it is going to be too costly here. That is why resource should be what you call, resources are those things which are found in the nature, and it should possess three qualities such as technologically accessible, culturally acceptable and economically feasible. Further we see that these transformation of resources or human beings are the main component, human beings are the main things who are going to what you call make use of these resources. Here we see in the physical environment so many things are available, like we have seen forests are there. From forest we get wood, and from earth we get minerals we get. These all are being found in the nature, and it is being human beings interact with the physical environment and technology has been adopted, and after that institutions were formed. And through these institutions we see that, for example, if we are interacting in the physical environment and extracting gold, here we see that mining industries have been developed. And here we see that through these institutions, and we see that they will accelerate for economic development. Then we see classification of resources. For example, in a class there are 50 students, and if you want to select football team, we keep certain criteria or certain particular parameters to select the students in the football team. They should be good at playing, or they should be sportsmen and interested in football game. Only for such kind of students only we select. In the same way, so many things are available in nature, and all those resources have been classified under four. The first classification is on the basis of origin. On the basis of origin, once again we get biotic and abiotic resources. And the second type is on the basis of exhaustibility, means how much resources available to us. Based on that we see renewable and non-renewable resources. And on the basis of ownership, these resources are owned by certain people, and who are those, how it is being classified. The very first type here we are going to see is individual resources. Second one is community owned resource. Third one is national resources, and the fourth one is international resources. And based on the status of development, resources which are available and how far it is being utilized. On the status of development we see that again we see there are four types. The first type is called as potential resource, second one is developed resource, third one is called as stock, and the fourth one is reserve. Now let us learn the first type of classification. Under the first type of classification we are going to get two types here, biotic resources and abiotic resources. Then a question may arise, what do you mean by biotic resources? These are the resources which are obtained from the biosphere and have life. For example, plants, animals, fisheries, etc. All those things which have life are being termed as biotic resources. And the next one is abiotic resources. These are composed from the physical environment and which do not have life. For example, rocks are there, and minerals which does not have, they are found in the physical environment and does not have life. Examples are rocks as well as minerals. Then the second type is on the basis of exhaustibility. On the basis of exhaustibility, again we have two types. One is called as renewable resource, another one is called as non-renewable resource. A question may arise in the mind that what are renewable resources? Renewable resources are those resources which can be, as the name itself says, renewed, reused, regenerated, or replenished again and again. These resources are called as renewable resources. Example, solar energy, water. Though we make use regularly, the sun rises every day and we are making use of the sunlight, it is never going to get exhausted. In the same way, water. Water is available to us. We are regularly making use of water. Though it gets over in the form of water cycle, again it is being renewed. Then the next one is non-renewable resources. Non-renewable in the sense they cannot be renewed or reproduced again and again. Here, fossil fuels, and minerals are the examples. We see that these resources, formation of these resources will take place, I mean millions of years. Hence, it's our duty that to make what you call proper, judicious and sustainable use of all these resources. Because once if they get over, formation of these resources will take a very long process. Hence, we are supposed to make sustainable use of these resources. And the next one, the third type is ownership. On the basis of ownership, we see that first type is individual resources. Under individual resources, we see that an X person is there and he is the owner and he has 5 acres of land and he is having a building and all these things belong to that particular person. Means he is the owner of that particular property or he is the owner of that land. I may have a car and this car belongs to me and hence it is my own resource which is being owned by a individual privately. Second one is community owned resource, it is called. Then what do you mean by community owned resource? It is a resource which is being accessible to the whole community. Means all the community members can make use of this resource. It is privately owned by an individual, that is individual resource, and here we see all the community members can make use of this resource. And what are those resources? For example, playground, picnic spots, burial grounds, etc. Here we see these resources are accessible to the whole community. Take for example in the playground, we see that elderly people also go for morning walk and the younger generation will go to play certain games there. Here everybody is making use of the resource, either elderly, children and all type, I mean all people can make use of the resource. The next one is national resources. To know the meaning of national resources, we will see here an example, a rough map of India, in which we see that all the resources within the political boundary of a region or of a country, I mean all the resources which come under the territory, under the boundary of a country or a region are being termed as what you call national resources. Suppose if a country has oceanic border, if a country has got oceanic border, here 12 nautical miles, this 12 nautical miles, under this 12 nautical miles, whatever resources, may be forest, may be minerals, may be fishing, whatever is there, this all is being belong to this particular country itself. There is no need of anybody to take any kind of permission to make use of these resources. Suppose up to 200 nautical miles, from 12 nautical miles to 200 nautical miles, the region what we get is called as exclusive economic zone, it is called. Then a question may arise, up to 12 nautical miles we are making use of these resources and up to 200 nautical miles also this region belongs to that particular country only. Then why can't we make use of the resource available here? No, we cannot make use of those resources. To make use of, for example, if a country has got any kind of resource here in these water bodies and which could be utilized for the economic development of that country, then this particular country has to take the permission from United Nations because it is the world organization and hence we need to take the permission from the United Nations. This is about what we call a national resources. go with international resources. What are international resources? Here in the international resources, we see the resources beyond 200 nautical miles. The resources beyond 200 nautical miles. For utilization of these resources, no country has got any right as such to make use. These are called as international resources. So maybe there are so many resources are available, but no country has got the authority to make use of it. Now let us proceed to the next type, that is fourth type, on the basis of status of development. On the basis of status of development, we see that there are four types again: potential resource, developed resource, stock and reserve. Here, potential resources. What do you mean by potential resource then? These are the resources which are found in a region, but they have not been utilized. They have got the capacity to satisfy the human needs. They have the potential also, but they are not properly and they have not been fully utilized. Take for example in Rajasthan and in Gujarat. In Rajasthan there is abundant what you call solar energy. Solar energy is available, the potential is there, but it is not utilized. In the same way in Gujarat, which has got what you call it has got the potential of tidal energy, but it is not properly put to use. The next one is developed resource. These are the resources for which these have been surveyed. Their quality and quantity also have been determined for utilization. Means a survey is being conducted of the resource. We came to know that how much quality it is available. Not only that, what quantity, what quality and how much quantity it is available at the same time, which has been utilized also. So that kind of resource is being called as developed resource. For example, coal. It is believed that 25,000 crore worth of what you call tons of 25,000 crore tons of coal is available in India, and what you call survey is made, quality, quantity have been determined, and at the same time it is being used also. Such kind of resource is called as developed resource. And the next one is stock. What is stock? It is the resource which has got the potential to satisfy human needs. But thing is that we are lacking technology to make use of it. Resource is available, as the name itself says, stock we have in large quantity. It has got the ability to satisfy human need also. Potential is there, everything is there. But thing is that since we are lagging technology, we are not in a position to make use of this resource. For example, once again if we take coal. Here coal is being, from coal we can produce natural gas also. But thing is that from the coal field we can extract, we can convert it into natural gas. But thing is that we do not have the technology to access it. Is it clear? Then we go for a reserve. It is also nothing but a subset of stock. That is, potential is there, found in large quantity, able to satisfy the human needs. Technology is not there, but here certain resources we are intentionally not making use. Take for example, certain reserve forests are there. These forests have been kept it as reserve because we want to make, the next generation should make use of this resource. Suppose if we recklessly make use of this resource, it may get depleted. Hence, we kept it as a reserve that the future generation can make use of it. Hope you might have understood today's topic, that is meaning and classification of resources. Children, based on this, we will provide you the worksheets also. Hence, you need to complete the homework. Hope you might have understood the topic.